I am going to be showing you guys about chapter 1-2, properties of real numbers, natural numbers, whole numbers, integers, rational numbers, and irrational numbers. So I'm going to go through these and give you a couple examples of each. You know, the way I usually think of these is, you know, the way you learned them in math class and how old you were. You know, what natural numbers were the first things you learned. You know, that's the way we originally taught you how to, about numbers, you know. We started off by teaching about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, et cetera, et cetera. You know, counting numbers, however you want to think about them. Then an amazing thing happened, you know, somewhere along the way, we taught you about the number 0 and all the numbers that came after it. And 0 is an incredibly important number. Dot, 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 dot. You got all those. And then, I don't know how old you were, maybe 4th, 5th, 6th grade. Maybe later or earlier, depending on, you know, what teacher you had. We taught you about integers, and all of a sudden there were all these negative numbers as well. You know, I had, you know, -3, -2, -1, and then 0, 1, 2, and all those numbers that came after it, as well as the one that came before -3, which would be -4, -5, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that would be the integers. So the only difference between the whole numbers and the integers is the negative numbers. The only difference between natural numbers and whole numbers is that whole numbers includes the number 0. And then we got into rational numbers. And rational numbers are a whole lot of numbers. In fact, rational numbers make up almost all of the numbers that you've been introduced to. You know, fractions, decimals, you know, maybe I got this number that keeps going on and on and on forever. I got 1, 2 regular numbers as well. You know, it could be an improper fraction, which is a number where the numerator is bigger than the denominator. That's okay. Decimals, 6.1. So those are all rational numbers. And a good definition that I like to use for rational numbers is, you know, anything that can be written as a fraction. It would be a rational number. Okay. So, you know, like this, you know, if I had the number 1/3, for example, you know, that's 0.3333. So 0.33 repeating, you know, that's something that can be written as a fraction. You know, it'd be 1/3. So therefore it's rational. Now on the flip side, there's irrational numbers. And irrational numbers are decimals that go on forever with no pattern. So that's the good the definition I like for irrational numbers. You know, and you've come across some of them. Most of them will occur when I take the square root of a non-perfect square. So, you know, if I took the square root of 2, for example, you know, you can punch that in your calculator and it'll tell you it's 1.212, but, you know, that's a rounded off version of the number. 1.414, not 1.212, 1.414. Which is a rounded off version, because there's a whole lot of numbers that keep going on and on and on forever and ever after that. So even though my calculator tells me it's 1.41421352, that's a rounded off. It keeps going. The calculator rounded off at a certain point. So anytime you take the square root of a non-perfect square, square root of 7, square root of 5, those will all give you irrational numbers. Square root of 4 would be different, because the square root of 4 is 2. So therefore, that one would be rational, not irrational. There is a couple of other ones that you might have come across. Pi is probably the most famous one. You know, people memorize how many digits of pi, 250 of them after the decimal point, because you have to memorize them because there's no pattern to it. There's a couple other ones. E is another one that you'll be introduced to in this class. So those are the main irrational ones. Okay. So those are the main categories of numbers. And, you know, and some of the word problems, the problems you might come across, this is one example. It says your school is sponsoring a charity race, which set of numbers does not contain the number of people in the race. And this is a multiple choice question, which is probably everybody's favorite kind of question. A, natural numbers. B, integers. C, rational numbers. Or D, irrational numbers. Okay, so natural numbers. Natural numbers, remember, those are like, you know, your regular kind of numbers, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So certainly I could have 5 people in the race. You know, integers, could it be integers? I mean, you don't usually have negative people in the race, but it doesn't say that, you know, it doesn't say that it has to have be all of the numbers in that number group. So, you know, remember, 5 is also an integer. So that could be it. Certainly could be a rational number as well, you know, because remember, rational numbers, anything that could be written as a fraction. So 5 is actually a rational number because 5/1 is, you know, can be written as a fraction. That's still 5. Now, irrational numbers, like I told you, are long decimals that go on forever and ever with no pattern, which means it would be real difficult to have, you know, the square root of 2 people in your race. So that would be the correct answer for there, okay? So that's one example of a question you might see. Number 2, I'm just going to start showing you some more problems here, questions you might come across in your first quiz or test in this class. Number 2, graph these numbers on a number line. It's so sloppy. Okay, and my numbers are -5/2, square root of 2, and 2.6 with the 6 repeating. Remember that bar means the 6 repeat, so that's really 2.66666666, and it keeps going on forever and ever and ever. All right, so if I do a quick number line over here, then that'd be perfect. Let's see, I like to have 0 somewhere over here. Here's 1, 2, 3. -1, -2, -3. All right, so let's graph these on a number line. 2.666, I'll approximate, that's about here. Between the 2 and the 3, closer to the 3 than the 2. Let's see, -5/2, if you turn that into a decimal, that's -2.5, so that's right here. And the square root of 2, I told you that was 1.414, so that's, we're kind of approximating somewhere around here, okay? You'd have to probably punch that into a calculator unless you happen to know that number. Okay, so there we go. They're graphed on a number line. I think I'm all good. You could compare them if you needed to, figure out which one's bigger or smaller. Remember, smaller is farther on the left, okay? So the one that's tricky is, you know, -7 is smaller than 1. For example, even though, you know, 7 is a more powerful number, -7 is farther to the left on the number line than 1, therefore it's smaller, okay? All right, number 3. I'll do the square root of 17 and 3.8 compare. All right, so let's see. And they give some directions, which is good because that's kind of a vague kind of question. Use greater than or less than. All right, so if I put the square root of 17 over here and 3.8 over here. Now, this is one of those questions where, you know, maybe it's a non-calculator question, not allowed to use a calculator. So if I start thinking about, you know, perfect squares, you know, 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, 81, 100, 121, 144, 169, 196, 225, is up to 15 times 15. So square root of 16 would be 4, right? So square root of 16 is 4, which means the square root of 17 is slightly above 4. How much more above 4? I'm not really sure, but without using a calculator. So let's see, which means if this is bigger than 4, say it's about 4.1 maybe, just for ha-has, that's bigger than 3.8. Is there any way that, you know, the square root of 17 is less than 3.8? No, because, you know, square root of 17, we already said, is greater than square root of 16. So therefore, that's bigger. Could it be equal to it? No, it couldn't be equal to it. So I'm not going to put any line underneath the greater than or less than, because remember, if I put one of these things, that means it's greater than or equal to, but this can't be equal to it because 3.8, you know, square root of 17 is bigger than 4. I know that. I don't know if it's 3.1, 4.1, or 4.2. Doesn't really matter. You can punch in your calculator and tell me in class tomorrow. All right. Next, I got some properties of real numbers that I'm going to go through with you. First one is commutative property. 2m's. I'm just going to abbreviate property with PROP. So there's two of them here. We either for addition, and then I've also got for multiplication for all of these. All right, so for addition. You know, an example would be, you know, commutative property means I can change the order. A plus B is the same as B plus A. And I think of that because, you know, people have a commute. I have a commute. I drive from home to work. And then at the end of the day, I go from work to home. It's the same drive. It's the same distance. However, the order has been switched. So that's how I remember commutative property. With multiplication, it's the same thing, except instead of having a plus sign, change that to capital A so I can be consistent. A times B is the same as B times A. These only work for addition and multiplication, okay? You can't change the order and have things be the same with subtraction or division. 4 minus 6 is not the same as 6 minus 4. 1 divided by 2 is not the same as 2 divided by 1, as I'm sure you guys have encountered in your life somewhere along the way. Okay, next, I got the associative property. And an example of this is where I've got A plus B plus C is going to be the same as A plus B plus C, but the parentheses moved. So the associative property, you know, that's about the parentheses. You move the parentheses, okay? Which two are associating with each other? You know, when I think about kids in the hallway, you know, they're sitting there, three kids having a conversation, one person's talking to the second person, and the second person's talking to the third person. It's still the same people associating, but, you know, who's communicating with who can change. So that's how I remember that. If you have a different way to remember it, all the power to you. And you can do the same thing with multiplying. If I go A times B times C, that will be the same as, I think I ran out of space here. Gotta like it when you can shrink the notes. Move it over even. Okay, so if I switch the order, I got A times B times C. However, if I move the parentheses around the B times C instead of the A, that would be the associative property. All right, so there's three of them. I got one more. No, I got two more, sorry. I got the identity. property. And the identity property is, you know, what I would add to it to have it stay the same. So there's two different things here. If it's addition, I could always add zero to it and it would stay the same. If it's multiplication, then I could multiply anything times one and have it stay the same, which is the identity, just like you have an identity that doesn't change, okay? All right, so there's that one. Next is the inverse. So when you talk about an additive inverse, that means you're adding, you know, the same thing except it's negative, whatever makes it zero for addition. For multiplication, it's a little different because I don't want it to be turn out to be zero. I want it to turn out to be one, which means I'm going to multiply by one over whatever that thing is. In this case, a times one over a would give me one. There is a little thing over here. Anytime we have a variable in the denominator, we need to kind of say that a, oops, that should be capital A, can't be zero because you can never ever divide by zero. Math. All right, so there we go. Those are my, oh, and I got one more. Sorry, I'm looking at my notes. I got one more. The last one, which is probably the most used one, is called the distributive property. This is the one you guys can probably spell this distributive. And this is where, you know, you take the one thing outside the parentheses and you multiply it times the two things inside. You probably see me see your teachers go like this. Is AB plus AC. Yep, that's it. Great, so those are the properties. The distributive property doesn't have one for addition and multiplication since, you know, you got both of those involved already in the distributive property. So there's the, you use an addition and multiplication. So it's really more of a multiplication kind of property, but anyway. So let's see, what number was I on? I did three of them up here. I'm on number four. And for number four, which property does this illustrate? I'm gonna write the directions here and this will be for a few problems. Negative 2/3 times negative 3/2 equals 1. All right, so let's see that one. I multiplied two things together and I got 1, which would be the inverse because I flipped it upside down and multiplied by it. When you do that, it's called the multiplicative inverse. You know, we use that a lot. Multiplicative inverse, when we talk about slopes and perpendicular lines, you know, the negative reciprocal, that's reciprocal implies inverse. All right, there's the first one. Number two, or number five rather. 3 times 4 times 5 equals 4 times 3 times 5. All right, so this one's a little tricky because you got to look at it, you know, and I know that, you know, most of us, anytime we see parentheses, we're thinking associative property. However, if you actually look at it, you know, what's inside the parentheses didn't change. So it's not actually the associative property. What did change is the order. You know, I switched the 3 and the 4, okay? So the difference is I just switched these two and then I got this over here. which means it's actually the commutative property. So that's the tricky. About as tricky as those get, I think. Okay. All right. So that was chapter 1-2. Close it out with a little bit more music and see y'all soon.